So very good morning, everyone. It's another remarkable day for us. This is 75-year-old Pioneer Engineering Institution, Government College of Technology, and means it's old. It has developed quite a lot of great engineers. Even before Government College of Technology, we have eminent engineering peoples, those who have developed from this Coimbatore. So today, means we have a very eminent person from a great organization, and the topic is a very, very important topic. So I don't want to take much of the time at the beginning. I straight away go with a student, Nega, third year EEE student from Government College of Technology, to welcome all the participants and of course the chief guest. Nega, please.
Good morning, sir. On behalf of Government College of Technology, I'd like to invite you for this lecture, and we are very glad to have you here, and I'm very eager to listen to all what you would like to talk about energy storage, sir. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you. And now, before I'm handing over the session to Krishnan sir, I invite third year student Jeevita to introduce the chief guest. Of course, he is well known to me, but means there are many participants, those who are connected online and offline in YouTube. So I request third year student Jeevita to introduce the chief guest. Yeah.
Yes, sir. Yes. Pleasant morning to all enthusiastic engineers. Very glad to introduce Mr. Krishnan Rajagopalan, Global Head, Business Development and Proposals, Hybrid and Energy Storage Division, Sterling and Wilson Private Limited. He did his M.Tech in NIT Trichy, and he completed his MDP in IIM Ahmedabad, and he completed his Business Operations Management in Panasonic Japan. Mr. Krishnan Rajagopalan leads the global business development and proposals functions for the hybrid and energy storage business at Sterling and Wilson, an Indian multinational engaged in engineering, construction, manufacturing, and energy services with over $1.7 billion USD in revenue. With little over 18 plus years of experience, our chief guest is passionate, successful, and vastly experienced techno-commercial and business development professional with a master's degree in engineering and certified development courses in management and business operations. He has handled roles in sales, business management, and project development, including overall P&L responsibility. He is passionate about energy and sustainable technologies in the renewable space and a well-traveled business manager. He possesses deep understanding of streamlining business operations and employee engagement to meet organizational objectives. As a passionate sports athlete in his younger days, he carries the same enthusiasm, leadership, and compassion towards his profession. It's just a nano part of our guest, and kindly proceed the session, sir. Thank you.
Yes, thank you, sir. Probably means I will take one more minute. Sorry for that. To talk about him personally from my end, I have seen quite a lot of people, those are technically great. I have seen quite a lot of people, they are administratively great. I have seen quite a lot of people, their business aspects, they are great. But unfortunately, mix of all, I have never seen till I have met him in a hotel in Chennai about 6 months back. I mean, he's an amazing guy. He's basically a chemical engineer, but last session when I have met in Energetan, he has given a beautiful lecture on the electrical side also. So it's also a message for the students, not only from the technical perspective, but also from other aspects. Like an engineer, you should not only think purely from the technical perspective, but also how to convert that technical into a business, how to manage a team, how to, enlarge that to the global market. So I believe, sir, we are expecting just not a small technical portion. We expect, technical, business development, managerial, even gender parity. Last time you have talked about amazing. So there are quite a lot of female students, which young talent, which is really, I can say, they are diamonds, but we have to sharpen it. I think you are the right person to sharpen the diamonds in GCT. Yes, sir, please.
Thank you, Selva. Thank you very much. It's a very good morning to everybody. Thanks, Neha and Jeevita. Your words are really it means a lot. While I don't know whether I'm worth to those words, but thank you very much to make that day very good for me. Selva, you've always been a very fantastic person to be with as a human being, and also a technocrat, which from an industry experience, you went on to venture out into a business, and the kind of networking and the service that you guys doing from Power Projects. I have seen many consultants who do paid services. You know, for every doubt you ask, they charge you. But here, for the last few months during COVID, the kind of webinars and seminars that you're conducting, not only for corporate people, but also for young students and engineers, really commendable, Selva. I'm really talking about it from my heart. So keep it up, Selva, and whatever support from an industry point of view we can offer, we will always be there to support such initiatives. GCT, welcome all for this. Thank you very much for, during a COVID stressful situation, attending a seminar on a techno-commercial kind of a mode on a Saturday morning. It needs a lot of, I would say, interest. I really thank you for that interest shown by all the students and staff. Coming to GCT again, in all our life, when we complete our 12th standard and we envisage to getting into an engineering college, the first step that you take on to keep into an engineering college is a remarkable day, right? I had that opportunity to do it before even I finished my 12th standard. So my sister, who was the state second rank holder in her 12th standard, her first admission in the electrical and electronics batch was in Government College of Technology, Coimbatore, in 1994. So with that small bag, we landed up. I was accompanying her for the first day with my daddy. The first step that I kept as an engineer in my life is GCT. So thank you for that opportunity. Though I was not joining in GCT, but I went to GCT to admit my sister. And of course, after the you have that, you know, ranking mechanism in the state government list. She was there in GCT for 3 months, and after that, she got her admission in electronics and telecommunication in REC Trichy. Now it is NITT. So she joined there. She went, but that 3 months she used to tell me a lot of stories about GCT. So to start with that, I think that is a memorable moment for me to GCT, and this is the next time I'm talking about or aligning myself with GCT. So it gives me a very great pleasure after 26 years. COVID, just before getting into my presentation, I just want to add a small tone to this COVID situation. We all know as youngsters, not me, of course, is COVID is a man-made thing. It is not a natural thing which happened. So it is our mistake as human beings that we created this pandemic, and we have to learn to live with it. There is no point in curbing about somebody like China did it, or somebody like America did it, or India did it. It is us as human beings, we did and we spoiled this environment to such extent to get such pandemics in every decade. If you take a normal immune development of a virus which has to go against the human immunity, it takes 100 years. But in the last 30 years, we had three such viruses which has created: H1N1, SARS, Ebola, and now pandemic COVID-19. These are not created by the nature, it is created by human beings. So my message to all of you is to maintain self-hygiene, respect human the world, and respect nature, and make sure that in every bit of your life, in every day, just do one thing which saves nature. That is the only thing that we can leave for our next generation. Thank you so much with that. I will get into my presentation. I will share my screen. Just tell me if you're able to see my screen. Just give me a minute. Yeah, I hope my screen is visible now.
Yes, sir, it's visible now. Yes, perfect, sir. Good to go.
Okay, microgrids and energy storage. So we will split this presentation into two parts. One is microgrids and energy storage. It will be a transition from microgrids to energy storage, because energy storage is an integral part of any microgrids. Before getting into it, I think you have already noted down my profile. So my mobile number is there. Please note it down, or you can even go to my LinkedIn. Just type Krishnan Rajagopal and Sterling Wilson. You will get it. Please give me your feedbacks. Anybody wants to be in touch with me, you're most welcome. I would be happy to share my thoughts, support you in terms of what's happening in the business environment when you guys finish off your fourth year of engineering. Probably we may also have some vacancies that will get developed in our organization. So that's for you to be in touch with me. So the presentation will be shared with you through Selva. You don't need to note it down, or if somebody wants to note down, please note it down. Just to give you an overview about Sterling and Wilson, where I am employed as Global Business Development Head. So we are a 93-year-old company, started in 1927. Totally more than 11 gigawatts of solar, gas and cogeneration plants commissioned globally. 11 gigawatts is 11,000 megawatts of capacity. The revenue is slightly over 2 billion. I think it's a very... I would say tremendous growth story of a company in the engineering space, particularly in the EPC space today. The parent company, which is Shapoorji Pallonji Group, is a $7 billion revenue company, which is a 150-year-old company. We operate across 37 countries. Currently, about 24 countries, our current projects are happening on ground. We have been awarded many excellence awards across the globe. IHS Market, which is a German-based engineering consultancy company, or I would say a marketing certification agency, has certified Sterling Wilson as world's largest solar EPC company in 2017, 18, 19, continuously for 3 years. This year, 2020, because of COVID, we are the second largest EPC company in the world in the solar space. That's an introduction about Sterling Wilson as a group. We are into all these businesses. I represent the first top one, which is hybrid and energy storage. We also are into power generation, basically gas and liquid fuels generation systems. We are into solar PV. We are into diesel generation. We are into transmission and distribution and substation work. We are also into MEP, mechanical, electrical and plumbing work for residential and commercial and industrial applications. We also build turnkey data centers like Amazon, Google, Microsoft, Vodafone, Netflix are all our customers where we build a complete turnkey data center for them. Okay, coming to the topic today, we will try to make it more interesting. It will have both techno-commercial inputs. Whenever you have some doubts, please put it onto the chat box. We will try to organize some Q&A session at the end so that your questions you can keep recorded. I will try to answer as much as possible. And also I will invite Selva whenever he feels he could answer some of the questions. I am not an electrical engineer, as Selva told. My entire education is in chemical engineering, but I am a very passionate energy enthusiastic. So I selected, though I was a core chemical engineering graduate, I selected energy as my career. So right from my first job that I started in 2000, I started into the energy space. So we will cover most of these topics. What is microgrid? We will try to understand what forms and needs of microgrids are there. How do we operate a microgrid? What is the difference between a conventional and a typical microgrid and market potential for? Market potential is very important for you guys to know, is that if you choose microgrids as one of your key carrier, I would say area, you need to also understand what is the kind of potential that you have in that space so that your job opportunity or growth opportunities, you will be able to understand. Then slowly, gradually, we move on to energy storage. What are the categorization and technology applications in energy storage? What is the present and future trend? Techno-commercial comparison, which is important for you to understand. Any technology, this is one input I want to give it to all your engineering students, is that in the 4 years of our engineering, you always read test books, you run simulations, you understand the technical engineering behind a subject. But it's also important for you to take examples and case studies. Now you have to just think about it, like in the colleges, the professors and assistant professors, they tell you always that take a case study and do it. The reason behind doing case studies is that you will understand the techno-commercial understanding behind it. Whenever you do a case study, you just don't do the case study only from a technical point of view, because all engineering, whatever we read or whatever law, science that we read, if they are not commercially put it across to the industry, then it has got no meaning. Like for example, you may build a very great rocket, but if the rocket doesn't have a propelling speed to cross the gravity of or if it is not economical and the budget is not made viable for a country, never that country will take that technology and go forward. So that is what is important in techno-commercial understanding. Again, market growth. Any subject that you read, please start understanding, go to Google and understand what is the market moving towards. Like, for example, in the electrical industry, start looking at what is the EHV side is happening and the high voltage side. Select some of your subjects. Like, you can be a very good expert in power systems market. So start understanding power systems area, reliability, grid level, what is happening in grid. So these are important things for you to shape up your interview processes when applications are asked for young engineers in such organizations. So application understanding and cost driver is also important to understand. Revenue stack. Any technology that you study, what is the technology providing as a revenue? You talk about a mobile phone. What is the revenue for mobile phone manufacturers? You need to understand those. Otherwise, what is the point in inventing a technology and delivering that technology to the world? BSS, services and operation, value chain, and market players. Market players is very key for you to understand who are the companies that are there in the space, who you can approach, start approaching, or start building your network in LinkedIn with those companies so that they identify you as a potential candidate. And this is very important in engineering space where you spend most of your time going into not Facebook or something, try to be in LinkedIn. LinkedIn is a tool where you can find these kind of industry people to align with them and network with them. Let us understand what is microgrid. What is a microgrid? A microgrid is nothing but a localized group of energy electricity sources. What I say basically is that you have a macro grid. Macro grid is nothing but your electricity utility grid, like, you know, the distribution company like Tangent Co, the TNEB grid, which is supplying a macro level state and it runs traditional power across the state. But wherein a micro grid is within a small space, you have your own energy sources and you have your own load profile. And then you create a kind of a grid within that source of energy and the load application to make it completely independent. And that is exactly what is called as a microgrid. And second is, microgrid always plays a backup role for a grid in case of an emergency. I will give you an example. There was a time when Mr. Modi, our honorable Prime Minister, when the COVID situation started, he told that for 9 minutes, we will put all our grids to off and we will take a candle and stay there. You know what is the level of power that got dropped in the grid? 26.7 gigawatt hours of power that went just like that out of the grid. This creates a huge imbalance in the grid, but still they could maintain the grid very stably. Just imagine in all your houses, you have a small solar plant or you have a small wind turbine, you have a battery and you run your home with that power. The grid, you don't need the grid at all. Anytime you can come out of the grid and take your own power with your own sources. And that is exactly what this microgrid is all about. At your place, you have the generation source, you generate the power, you store it, you use it. And that becomes a local reliable source of power for you. And that is defined as microgrid. How does microgrid form? A microgrid is always formed by multiple sources of energy. For example, I have talked about here in the diagram, you have DC source of solar, you have an AC source of wind, you have an energy storage system, which is again a DC generation. What you do is that you convert or invert them. So if you are converting from AC to AC, it is a converter. Then if you have a DC to AC, it is an inverter. So solar is a DC panel. We all know it is a semiconductor device which generates low voltage, and that voltage is snatched out by a inverter, and that inverter converts that voltage into an AC, and then you step it up to high voltage using a power transformer, and then you put it into the AC bus. AC bus is nothing but your grid system, right? So here, if you see, the loads are on the right side. You have a circuit breaker before the main grid. What we mean by the main grid, as I explained to you, you have your home and there is an electricity board giving you an electricity supply from the grid, and that grid is called as main grid. Your home system is called as the microgrid. So this is how a typical microgrid is formed. So you have your source, which can generate DC or AC. You have an energy storage system, which will store the power and make sure that the transient power supply to the loads are stable. And then you have the load on the other side. You create a breaker, which means you have an isolator, which completely isolates the main grid versus your small grid. Who are all the major applications for microgrids? You can have hospitals, anybody for that matter. A village can have a microgrid. A hospital can have a microgrid. A neighborhood can have a microgrid. A small store can have a microgrid. Anybody can. A farmer who is doing his farming can also have a microgrid. So microgrid can glorify at any place, any time. What you need is a simple energy source available. And which is the major energy source available in the world today is solar, because it is free. It has got abundant amount of energy, and it is one of the main features of a microgrid whenever you form a microgrid. What is the need of a microgrid? Why do you need microgrids? Microgrids are basically the answer for energy crisis. I will give you a very staunching, but also a very, I would say, very disheartening example. I am sitting here in Mumbai. Mumbai, everybody knows, is a city with more than, I don't know, maybe 2 crore population. The floating population itself is in Mumbai is a 50 lakh. The Mumbai city never gets a power cut, which means we pay heavy amount of power cost, and the electricity board maintains 24/7 power to the Mumbai city. There is a place called Palghar, right? Everybody know about, there is a mob lynching happened in Palghar, where some of the sadhus were, you know, hit by some mob, right? And in the same Palghar district, there is a tribal area, which is just 65 kilometers from Mumbai, 65 kilometers. I myself has gone and installed we donated a microgrid there when I was in Panasonic. In the evening, 6 o'clock, if you go to that hilltop and be with those villages, remote villages in the tribal region, you will be able to see that the Mumbai lights go up, these people's lights go down. Just 65 kilometers from Mumbai, people have not seen power. This is the situation in some of the tribal areas in India. The answer for them is microgrid. They can generate their own power. They can use it for their own use. Second biggest need for microgrids is transmission and distribution losses. Everybody know that when you are generating power at one station, for example, we all know that there is a power generation station in Ennore. There is a thermal power plant in Ennore. There is a thermal power plant in Neyveli Lignite Corporation. They are all 2,500, 3,000 megawatts of thermal power plant. How does that power transmit to Coimbatore? We have transmission line, which are like 220 kV, 132 kV. Then they are stepped down to 11 kV. And then they are given to industries at 11 kV. Then it comes to 415 volt. Then it is converted to single phase, three phase, and it is coming to your home. In all these processes, there is a conversion of energy that is happening. Energy is getting transmitted from one form to the other form. What are the conversions happening? When you are generating, you are generating through a heat source, right? That is a thermal process. We call it combustion and boiler steam turbine Rankine cycle. You generate power through heat source. You convert it into kinetic energy in the shaft. It gets converted into electrical energy to the electromagnetic alternator. Then that electrical energy is again converted into a heat energy while it is transmitted through the transmission line. These transmission lines are conductors. You have a square mm with size of those conductors, because based on the current carrying capacity. But when you are pumping so much amount of high voltage current into that transmission line, there are heat that is generated, and that heat dissipates some of the electricity that is already generated into another form of into the air, and that creates a lot of losses into the system. So microgrids is another answer for avoiding those losses, because you create in your own place, you are consuming it in your own place. You don't need to transmit it, so your losses are heavily reduced. The third part that you achieve is a carbon footprint reduction. In a microgrid system, you don't need a coal. You can use gobar gas, means we used to talk about biogas. Like, you know, you put that cow dung into a place, it generates bio CNG or bio natural gas, methane. You can put it into a small engine, generate power, use it. You can use a solar. All these are natural forms of energy. So microgrids is one of the major source of reducing carbon footprint in the electrical industry. And second, it provides high reliability to the critical loads. What are all the critical loads? I just told you, in a tribal area where people have not seen light in their lives, for them, a bulb which gives them light in their one small hut is a biggest form of critical load. A mobile phone, if they can charge, or those children, if they get one small bulb, LED bulb, lit by the current, that is a critical load for me. Not the critical load like how you run an industry or a factory. These people have money. They don't even have that. In those areas, microgrids gives them reliable power. For example, even if you take your own college, there are data centers. You have a library. You have a computer center. You have servers running. Those are critical loads for you. You cannot. If they are binary digits, if there is power goes off in your computer system, all your data is gone. So those are critical loads. So microgrids offers high level of reliability to those critical loads. Let's understand what are the operational modes of microgrids. There are only two operational modes. One is islanding mode. The other one is grid mode. What is an islanding mode? So if you look at the circuit diagram, basically simple circuit diagram, you have a point of coupling, which is basically the feeder that is coming from the grid. The point of common coupling is basically the grid connecting point. You have a circuit breaker, or you can call it as a switch. The switch is always open, which means the current doesn't flow into the circuit. But the feeder A, B, C, which are your loads in the microgrid system, gets fed by the microgrid. The feeder 4, which is the feeder D, which is a critical load, which is connected to the common grid. It is completely isolated from the feeder A, B, and C. This is a microgrid which is into islanding mode operation, which means the static switch is always open. The current doesn't flow from the grid to the microgrid. And you can always have a possibility that whenever you want to close it, you can close the circuit breaker and you can take power from the grid. If your solar panel doesn't operate in your microgrid, you can just close it and it will go onto a grid mode. And this is exactly called as an islanding mode of operation. Typically, an islanding mode of operation where the grid is completely disconnected from the majority of your loads, whether it is an industrial load or a electrical vehicle load or a household load or an appliance load or a compressor load or a battery. This is completely disconnected, where you can see that there is a switch, which is basically a circuit breaker, which is always kept open. The second mode is a grid connected mode, where you keep the connection point outside the circuit, where there is always a continuous flow of grid connection through the circuit, where the circuit breaker is always kept closed, which means the connection is always there within the circuit system. So you are supplying power to feeder A, B, C, and D through the grid power and also from the microgrid. And this is a grid mode, connected mode application of a microgrid. Typical formula. So the PCC that you are seeing, which is more like a controller, and it is controlling the circuit breaker. So the power flows from the grid completely into the system. So you have both the options when it operate on a grid mode. Conventional grid versus microgrid. What is the basic difference between conventional grid and a microgrid? The efficiency of conventional grid is very low as compared to a microgrid, because in a conventional grid, you start generation at one place, which is thousands of kilometers away, and then you supply the power through multiple transmission grids, multiple distribution grids, multiple low tension, LV, low voltage, high voltage, and medium voltage systems. You have transformers, you have substations, everywhere there is mechanical and electrical losses. So the efficiency of the conventional grid is not so high. Whether we can completely take out conventional grid, not possible, because you need scale of operation, you need volume of operation to make it more competitive. So you need to have conventional grid also. But in areas where critical loads are there, where you feel that is a large amount of sources of local energy that is possible, you should go for microgrid. In the conventional grid, as I told you, large amount of energy is in the form of heat is wasted. As I told you, when you're transmitting, the transmission line generates a lot amount of heat. The electricity is wasted in the form of heat. Power sources in case of microgrid are small and located very close proximity to the load, which means in your house or in a small village, just above your house, you can put a solar panel. So the source is just above your rooftop, and then the load is above inside your house. So it is very, very close and proximate, and it is immediately consumed as and when it is generated, or you can store it and use it whenever you want it. That is the difference between conventional microgrids. What is a typical application of a microgrid in an island or a place where there is no grid available? So this is typical flow diagram, which can tell you that there is an island which has got a typical load. For example, island you can take, let's say, Andaman Nicobar Islands or Lakshadweep Islands, you know, something like that, where there are people living, there are commercial establishments there, so they need some power. So they run DG, they run diesel generators. So here, if you see, there is an existing DG of 600 kilowatt, 200 kilowatt, which means 1.4 megawatt of existing diesel generators operating. They are also thinking about putting up another 300 kilowatt of engines, which means 1.5 megawatts of diesel generators are operating. We are putting 3 megawatt solar. So for a 1.5 megawatt diesel generator, we are adding a microgrid where 3 megawatt of solar is added. Then you are putting up a converter, and on the other side of the grid, you are having a battery. So this is generally how the system will operate. So if you look at the battery sizing here, it is important to note that the battery sizing says 3 megawatt hour by 1 megawatt. What does that mean? We will, of course, deep dive into it a little more. This means the power delivery from the battery is always 1 megawatt, wherein the battery has a storage capacity of 3 megawatt hour of electrical energy. I hope you guys understand that. So you can store 3 megawatt hour of energy to the battery, but at any point in time, the battery will discharge 1 megawatt in 1 hour, right? Which means, what is the storage capacity we have built? We have built 3 hours of storage capacity. Now, how does that graphically work when a typical good solar day means when the sun is shining very well, you have good solar energy. How is the load gets addressed by this microgrid? See, the orange color and gray color on the left hand side and right hand side of the graph, it is where the diesel generators will operate. So though you have 1.5 megawatt hour of diesel generator, MVA of diesel generators, 4 generators you are having, but you are operating them for only very small time. Majority of the time, which is the blue color, is taken by the solar power plant. And while we go to the 3 hour journey, which means when the solar slowly gets down, when the evening starts, which is 3:30 and above. So 3:30 to 6 o'clock, the green color, which is the battery energy storage, that provides the energy to the grid, which is 1 megawatt. So now you understand how a microgrid operates. So here what you are trying to achieve is 60% of the diesel generator capacity, you are able to reduce the diesel consumption by supporting the microgrid with solar and battery storage. Here you are also integrating renewable energies, which is solar power plant. So your carbon emission from diesel generator is reduced, and the BESS maintains the critical support load to the grid, and also it behaves like a very smoothening system for the solar power plant. We talk about smoothening and some of the applications of energy storage as we go move forward in the energy storage space. I hope this gives you a very practical example of how a microgrid operates in conjunction with a diesel generator for an island operation whenever there is no grid available, and how do they distribute the load and supply the load with respect to the daytime and night and evening in a 24 hours time period. So this is typically how a microgrid operates. Advantages of microgrids, we have spoken it. It isolates itself very clearly whenever there is a utility distribution disturbance happens. What we mean by disturbance, but suddenly the frequency of the grid can go down, sudden drop in the load can happen. For example, you have a city, let's say Coimbatore, some big transmission substation is supplying power to you. Suddenly all of your people decide that you are going to put off your lights. The entire city decides that, okay, I will not have my lights, which means the substation is going to have a sudden decrease in the load demand. That time, the microgrid will completely isolate itself, like how we studied the islanding mode. The circuit breaker will open and the microgrid will continue to operate. The grid is stable. In peak load periods, what is peak load? For example, in an electrical grid, it is important for you to understand, in Indian grid, Indian electricity supply, there are 3 time of day charges, or you can say time of day supply of power. Anybody wants to understand this, please take your electricity bill of your home or the electricity bill of your college. Just go to your electrical department or your maintenance department. Ask them to give you a sample of the electricity bill that they get from TangentCo. In the electricity bill, you will see 3 different charges applied on the consumption in three different periods. The three different periods are morning peak. Morning peak is between 6 a.m. to 9 a.m. Day consumption, that is called as normal day period, which is between 9 a.m. to 6 p.m. Evening peak is between 6 p.m. to 10 p.m. And off peak is called as 10 p.m. to 6 a.m. in the night. So you have four different time zones, but there are three different tariffs. The daytime tariff and the off-peak tariff is the same, which means it is 5 rupees or 5 rupees 50 paise, depending upon which category of customer you are, whether you are a commercial customer or a residential customer. But the morning peak and evening peaks are charged differently. Why? Because we all know in India or any country, morning we get up, we use AC, we use cooking, we use heaters, the load goes up. In the daytime, all the loads gets converted into a commercial space because you go to college, your parents go to office, nobody is there in the home. So the load goes down, but the load in the commercial space increases. Evening peak, the load in the restaurants increases, load in the hotels increases, parties, commercial activities, people go to shopping malls. But at the same time, residential load also increases because you start putting ACs, you're back to your home. You're cooking, you're using mixer, you're using your grinder. So this is the variation in the loads that happens. But wherein if you take an industry, industry is constant. So industry's continuous loads keep on happening. When this kind of peak load variation happens, suddenly evening the power requirement goes up. The grid has to supply that amount of power. So whenever you have a microgrid and I take my load outside the grid, the peak power requirement for the grid will go down. So the microgrid also helps there. Significant amount of carbon reduction we have already seen. You are using solar and wind and all, so you are not using diesel power, so you are reducing carbon footprint. You are also very close to the proximity, so there is no heat generation and loss of electricity in a microgrid. Microgrid also electricity cost to the generators because you are generating within your own sources. The only capital cost is important. You put a capital cost, but your operational cost for a microgrid is very negligible. Also, microgrids have got disadvantages. Because it is a very small system, the voltage fluctuation, power quality, and how do you work in synchronization with the larger grid, it is a very, very critical parameter. So in order to control those parameters, it is to be very precise. So that is one area, because in a microgrid, your energy balance, what does energy balance means? The energy that you are generating is from an infirm supply. What is infirm supply? Solar is not a firm supply. Even in a day also, 9 o'clock to 10 o'clock, sun will be very bright. Suddenly one cloud will pass between 10 to 11 a.m. The solar generation will drop. So a 1 megawatt solar plant can go down to 200 kilowatt. Again, it will come back to 1 megawatt when the sun will again come out after the cloud. So this fluctuation is called as infirm power supply. But wherein a grid, when you're running a boiler-based, coal-based power plant, it supplies firm power supply. It is continuous supply. There is no interruption of supply. So when you have this kind of grid balancing, and then you have to adjust the frequency and voltage and power quality with the grid, the criticality of controlling the microgrid becomes very difficult. And the electrical energy excess needs to be stored in a battery. Today, the battery is expensive because you need to replace the battery after some time and all. So battery prices are going down. So we will read that, how battery is becoming more critical in development of microgrid and how the industry is moving. That is also important. Resynchronization. Once your microgrid is unsynchronized, resynchronizing with the grid is also very difficult. And then protecting it from key challenges, what we have explained is also is a challenging point. And then once you want to operate in synchronization with the grid, then there are IEEE standards, there are high level of electrical standard that you need to maintain. Majority of the times in microgrids, those are not maintained. ESS requirement. ESS requirement is nothing but energy storage system requirement in a microgrid. It is a very crucial element of a microgrid. Now, we have seen what is a microgrid, what is the need of a microgrid, how a microgrid is formed, what are the modes of a microgrid operation. We have seen the application of microgrid, what are the advantages of microgrid, what are the disadvantages of microgrid, how it behaves with the grid. Now we are slowly moving towards what is the essential component of a microgrid, which is a battery storage. This is a transition that we want to do in the lecture. Selva, do we need to take a 2-minute break if somebody wants to have a water or just want to go for a bio break or something?
In the meantime, if you have questions also, we can take.
Absolutely. Yes. Yeah. So I'm just going out before we get into the ESS part. Dear students, so you can take a bio break. We can probably take a 5 minutes bio break. In the meantime, anybody wants to have any questions, please put for your questions, please.
Yes, they can probably unmute as well to post the question.
Yeah. One more suggestion: don't hesitate by asking a question, even if it's a very layman question that, Krishnan sir, I don't know your name. Please, can you tell me your name again? Even that kind of question, please ask. The only way of learning is to ask questions. So don't hesitate, because I was also exactly like you. I will keep quiet thinking that, you know, whether my question is right or not. Don't think like that. Please ask whatever questions you want to ask. Even if it is not related to the subject, you want to understand something exactly different, please put your questions.
Yes, sir. There are a few questions from YouTube which I am taking. Then probably we can go ahead with the questions from the participants.
Sure.
Yeah. Sure. How the frequency is stabilized in microgrid? That's a question from Milton C. from YouTube.
Okay. It's a very good question. So what happens when you have an infirm power supply into the grid is that your frequency drops. For example, India is operating at 50 hertz. So 50 hertz is a normal frequency for you. So the moment the frequency goes down, which means, let's say it goes to 49 hertz. What does that mean? Which means you need to pump immediate active power into the grid. So how do you do that in a microgrid? Through the storage. So whatever is the power that you have stored or the energy that you have stored in the battery, you will immediately pump that power into the grid to give the active power to the grid to bring back the frequency to 50 hertz. What will happen on the other side? If the frequency goes up, which means the frequency goes to 51, which means the grid is not able to take the amount of power that is getting pumped into the grid. Then what do? You draw the power from the grid and store it in the battery again in the microgrid to bring back the frequency again to 50. And this is what is called as a frequency regulation application, which we will anyway be seeing in our next session, which is our battery storage session.
Yes, sir. Thank you for that. And actually, there's an interesting question again from YouTube from Sankara Sudeep. I think he is very active on YouTube. There are quite a lot of questions and discussions from him. Everybody has the same question. I mean, so say, few people are talking about smart grid, few people are talking about micro grid. So, yeah. I mean, what's the difference?
Okay, very interesting question. It is a difference like telephone and mobile phone. Nothing beyond that. Any microgrid can also be a smart grid. What do you do with smart? It is just like a telephone that you are using. We used to have that Nokia phone, you know, button system. That is also a mobile phone. Today we are using a smartphone. Why do you call it smart? Because the features are different. You are able to control the features in a different platform, which is called as Android. That is exactly the difference between a microgrid and a smart grid. Smart grids has got communication protocols. It has got cloud-based control systems, it has got sensors, it has got IoT platform to control and operate a microgrid in a very smart manner. That is the only difference. Smart grid is not separate from a microgrid. Smart grid is an over layer of a microgrid where it is a smarter way of operating a microgrid. That is the fundamental difference between a microgrid and a smart grid.
Yes, sir. There is another question again from same Sankara Sudeep. About the controllers and communication. First question, do we have a communication in microgrid? So I think you can bit elaborate that because microgrid is still probably invisible area from the academics. At least they are reading it theory, but after quite a lot of practical installations and implementations, still I believe the students' community or academics' background, they are not able to visualize what is there really in the microgrids. Can you just talk a little bit on this controllers and communication?
Absolutely. Any system, any electrical, whatever system, even if it is a chemical process, anything needs control. Without control, it will go haywire. In an electrical system also, you need controllers. What are those controllers do? You generate power, you need to convert it from one voltage to another voltage. You need to pump that power into a transmission system. In all these processes, you need to have controllers because you need to generate it at a particular voltage constantly. You need to convert it from that voltage to another voltage more smoothly. Then you need to pump it to another voltage. Now, in this microgrid system, you also have battery. In the battery, you need to charge it and discharge it. So this charging and discharging also needs control. We call it BMS, battery management system. We call it DC panel. There are controllers inside the DC panel, which controls the charging current, which also controls the discharging current. So any system needs controller. So this is the majority, utilization of controllers in a microgrid system or a major system. Now you take the communication protocol. When you are doing all these things, why you need communication? Communication is needed for three things. One is the data that you need to extract from the system. How much of power is gone? How much of charging is happening? How much of discharging is happening? What is the health of the solar panel? What is the transformer heat rating? What is the temperature? What is the weather? All these data are captured by using sensors, by using instrumentation components there. And how do you get these data out is only through a communication channel. It could be a RS-485 communication protocol. It can be a Modbus. It can be now cloud computing is the best thing. So you put up a small chip into the system and it completely uploads all the data into your cloud. The third thing that you need for data is controlling and operating the plant. Because today, if you take microgrids, these are in remote locations. People operate these microgrids remotely. How do you operate? For operating a microgrid, you need to have data analysis. So these data analysis are done in servers or in control or in communication devices, where all these data are pumped to the cloud or through LAN or out through internet. They download all the data, they analyze through softwares, and they get analytic details. Oh, okay, this way, this period, the solar is generating like this, the battery charging. So they immediately give the signal back to the to the plant, and then the plant operates the system. So there are multiple uses of controllers and communication protocol. Without these, no system can operate efficiently.
Yes, sir. There are quite a lot of questions even in the chat box that is more related to means how do you stabilize grid with intermittent wind and solar. I think you are going to take that question when you are going forward in the energy storage.
Yeah.
So I am parking that question. I believe that is answered. There is another interesting question. Yes, you rightly told, nothing is a silly question. Probably everybody has a different view on this microgrid. So there's a question like from Angela Balaji, microgrid, is it an independent or not?
Absolutely independent.
Yes.
Mr. Balaji, your question is very valid. That is a fundamental that we saw today. Microgrids always are independent and they are also grid connected. So you have the choice of keeping it completely independent. So that is called as island mode of operation, which means you are completely cutting off your microgrid from a grid. The typical example that we showed is an island operation. In an island, you don't have a grid. You don't have a central grid going from, Tamil Nadu to Andaman Nicobar Islands. Andaman Nicobar Islands completely operate in diesel generation. They have diesel generators operate as a microgrid. That is a small grid that they have. So all microgrids are completely isolated. But if you want a microgrid to be connected to the main grid, you can also do that.
Yes, sir. Actually, means what to say, I don't expect you to take all these questions. I believe all these questions will be answered in your future slides. Like one is asking about the battery and battery used for an industrial microgrid, and other question how it is related with PV and the solar EV charging stations, microgrid, nanogrids, etc. I believe along the sessions you will answer these questions. Still, if any questions are not answered along your presentation, then we will take up that question again at the end. Yes, sir.
Sure, absolutely.
Yes.
So are we good to go for the second session?
Yes, sir. Yes.
Can we start?
Yes, sir. Yes,
sure. Okay. Thank you, Selva. Sorry. So I hope my screen is visible for all of you.
Yes, sir. Yes. Go ahead, sir. Good to go.
Thank you. So as we said, energy storage systems becomes a very vital part of a microgrid because of various reasons. For typical reasons is you want to store the power that you are generating at your own sources. You have to control and stabilize the frequency and voltages that happens in the microgrid versus the main grid. As I told you, it improves the reliability of the overall system. We will see how it improves the reliability. Sizing of the ESS, sizing of the battery system is a very critical first step when you design an entire microgrid system, because whatever is the solar power capacity that you will set, you will decide, or whether you will design a wind power capacity, it is important to size the battery capacity, because it has got multiple applications, and how much power you need, how much of energy shifting want you do, how much of storage capacity you want to build in. So ESS sizing becomes very critical in sizing a microgrid system. Sizing of a microgrid also in ESS system in also eases and shaves off the peak demand. As we explained, whenever there is a peak demand, you can always take your load out of the grid as becoming a microgrid. So that much amount of load is not put into the main grid. So the peak demand goes down. So you can do that. Energy shifting is a very critical parameter or application which is driving the microgrid and energy storage market in the industry. That we will see when we'll get into the energy storage system. So this slide is to just tell you that energy storage system, it is becoming an integral and critical part of any power systems today, whether it is microgrids or even main grids, it is becoming an integral part of it. With this, we will get into the understanding of what is the size of the microgrid. This is the last slide that I have in microgrids. This gives you a picture of what is the business volume in the globe. Just imagine 3,55,000 crores of potential business that can happen in microgrids. For all electrical and electronics engineers, or even environmental engineers, energy specialists, if you want to make your career in microgrids, this is the kind of business potential till 2025. And just see that 2025, after 2025, the country, the world keeps growing. You know, this is the market size. So this is the amount of revenue that microgrids can project or provide. And if you look at the countries that we are market, we are strong in these potential is America, Asia Pacific, majority is contributed by India and some of the Southeast Asian nations, then of course Europe and rest of the world. So America and Asia is one of the very large microgrid markets. Battery energy storage. This is a typical, I would say, a civil constructed building for a battery energy storage. All these things that you are seeing are called as racks, battery racks. Inside these battery racks, you have cells and modules of batteries. Before we get into a typical battery storage system, which is deployed very heavily in the country, it is also interesting to understand what are all the different storage technologies which are under deployment. I have categorized these storage systems into their basic science: mechanical storage, thermal storage, electrochemical storage, electrical storage, and chemical storage. And then what I have given you, I have graded or shaded them with gray color, which are all the most prominent energy storage technologies in the world today. Some of the mechanical storage, like pumped hydro. What is pumped hydro means? You have a hydropower plant, like for example, Mettur Dam. Just I take an example. You have a Mettur Dam. You have a one side where you have storing potential energy. Like, you know, you are storing water, it creates potential energy. Then when you release the water from the dam, it creates kinetic energy. You have a turbine, it generates power. What you can also do is, you can pump back the water into the dam again, and then again generate the same power. That is what is called as pumped hydropower. So which means the water which has already generated the power can again be stored back, pumped back and again be stored into the dam and again generate power out of it. This is a storage that you are creating, potential storage, which is a mechanical stuff. Compressed air storage. You can compress air and that creates an energy. When you release the compressed air, the energy gets released. That is another form of energy storage. Flywheel, we know about flywheels, which is basically, you guys have seen dynamo, right? In our olden days, I don't know how many people have actually driven a dynamo cycle. I have driven, maybe Selva might have also driven a dynamo based cycle.
Yes, sir.
It is a typical form of a dynamo, right? You keep churning the kinetic energy in your pedals. The dynamo is generating power for you, and it, the light glows. It is a form of a flywheel. You start the flywheel, then the momentum and inertia starts generating energy continuously. I just gave a dynamo as an example. Then comes thermal storage. Thermal storages are not very prominent in the industry today because of their high cost and some of the efficiency factors not being yet established. Electrochemical systems, they are the major, I would say, energy storage technologies used because of 3-4 reasons. One is they are cheap, they are abundantly available, and they are easily, I would say, manufacturable and compact and easy to install. They also have disadvantages because lead acid battery, after usage, it's a heavy metal, you have to, it's a pollutant. Lithium ion, again, while we are using more of lithium ion storage, even if your mobile phones, you have a lithium battery inside, what we will do after after that life, you have to again see how the recycling of those batteries can happen. Flow batteries like sodium sulfide or technologies that are also coming up where you can store battery power for a very long time. On an electrical side, we are talking about superconductors, supercapacitors, magnetic field based energy storage systems. These are also being talked about. I am not very well aware, or I'm not an expert in this. Chemical storage, hydrogen, fuel gas. These are already established process, but they are currently very expensive. Hydrogen as a chemical, as a storage system or energy producing system is becoming very, very prominent. People can go to net and see the entire Europe is talking about hydrogen based energy storage as their main thing, because it's one of the very purest form of energy generation and storage application. So please go to the net and read. You will get a lot of details about the thing. But out of all these storage technologies, the most prominent and widely used energy storage system is lithium ion. What are the categorization of electricity storage system application? So people ask some questions. I think Selva put in those questions. I think most of your questions will get answered here. There are majorly application families called ancillary services, behind the meter, energy trade, grid support and investment deferral. What does these mean? Let us take the first one, ancillary services. Ancillary services are nothing but non-revenue generation mainstream services. For example, frequency regulation. We explained about frequency regulation. We will see that in more detail. There is no mechanism how you can quantify the frequency regulation and get some money out of it. So there is no revenue mechanism. So it is an ancillary services. The frequency control is not generating power. Already generated power, you are only controlling it. Or there is some mechanism by which you are stabilizing it. So that is an ancillary services. It is not a mainstream service for you. Second one is black start ramping. Black start ramping is, for example, suddenly the grid is failing and you need to run the DG, which you are not able to do from the DG. You can do that from a battery. Microseconds, the battery will pump that much amount of power what you need from the system. This is an ancillary service again. You can also talk about voltage support and balance management. Voltage support, again, typically like frequency, if your voltage drops, the battery can pump power into the grid to stabilize the voltage. This is an ancillary service. This is not a main service of power generation. The second one is behind the meter. What is behind the meter? Behind the meter energy storage application is the application where you put up a storage system along with the generation asset. Generation asset is nothing but your solar system or your wind system. Before you pump the power into the grid, you have a storage alongside the solar plant itself. That is behind the meter. Before you measure what is the total amount of power which is generated, your storage is already there along with the solar. This is basically used for energy shift, also for smoothening of the solar power. We will see also what is smoothening of solar power. Grid support and investment deferral is, for example, if the grid wants to stabilize its transformer, there is a substation. The substation transformer is designed for a certain capacity, for distributing power to a particular village. Suddenly the village has grown, lot of commercial activity has happened in the village demand has increased, the transformer is not able to supply that much amount of power into the village. You have two options. You can enhance your grid. You can increase the transformer, you can increase the substation, you can increase your everything. Or you can simply put up a energy storage device. So whenever there is a load fluctuation happening because of load things, you can always stabilize that with an energy storage. This means the investment on the grid side can be deferred by putting up an investment on the storage space. That is the grid support and investment deferral application. So these are all the various places in which the application of energy storage is going to happen. One, somebody had asked question on EV charging. How is battery storage is going to be linked to energy store EV charging? EV charging is very, very clear. Your electric vehicle is going to consume a large amount of power. Let me give you a very practical example. Delhi distribution, power distribution company called as BESS, which is owned by the Delhi government in joint venture with Anil Ambani's Reliance Group. They are the power distribution company in Delhi city. So in many of the Delhi cities, their distribution space means the transformer, they're all indoor transformer. The substations are indoor substations. They don't have space to expand. But Delhi as a city is now moving towards a lot of electric vehicles, electric cars, electric autos, electric buses. So there, all they need is high current and delivery of high current. And since the transformers don't have spaces, they are overloaded, you can put up a battery energy storage container there and they can easily dispatch power to those cars that they want to charge. And fast charging can happen, slow charging can happen. These controls, you can do it in the energy storage batteries very beautifully. And this is a very major application for the EV industry. So without battery storage, EV industry's growth will be limited. Now, this graph tells you, or the block diagram tells you, what is the present power transmission system and distribution system and what is it going to be in future, including communication. So some people asked about communication. So communication is going to be a very essential part of any energy storage growth story. So in the current left side, current system, you don't have any energy storage. You generate power, you transmit it, it goes to substation, it gets used into the industrial complex or commercial complex or residential complex. But if you go to the right side, every spot you are now going to have energy storage system. You will have the energy storage system at the generation point, you will have energy storage system at the distribution point, you will also have energy storage system at the consumption point. This is going to be the change in the future power flow diagram in our entire industry. This is a comparison of the technology, various technologies that we saw with respect to techno-commercial information. Efficiency is basically taught to be like round trip efficiency, from charging the battery to completely discharging the battery, again charging it back to the level of the original time. It's called as one round trip efficiency. So the highest efficiency is currently provided by lithium ion and sodium sulfur, which is 80% to 95% of efficiency. And sodium sulfur provides almost like up to 90%. Discharge time, which means depending upon your application. For example, I want to discharge, we saw that island operation, right? Island operation, we had 3 megawatt hour of battery storage, but the discharge is 1 megawatt hour every year. So your discharge time is 3 hours. So each technology has benefit with respect to the discharging time. For example, if you want to have quick discharge, there is a disturbance in the grid. Those times you cannot have 1 hour of discharge. Within 5 minutes, microseconds or minutes, you need to discharge heavy amount of power. That discharge will be possible with respect to lithium ion energy storage. And flywheels, flywheels see 1 second. Lithium ion also can give you in microseconds the discharge. So then the application gets deferred, but lithium ion also can give you lot of storage capacity. But beyond 4 hours, lithium ion, why it is not very attractive is because of the cost. The cost goes up because you have to put more and more lithium ion battery. It doesn't make sense. But there, if you see flow batteries and sodium sulfur batteries, if you want to have very large storage capacities, for example, there is a village, after 6 o'clock, there is no power. The entire village needs power for the entire night, which is 10 hours. That time you can go for another technology, not lithium ion technology. Then you talk about C rating. C rating is nothing but charging and discharging rates. To just give you a very simple example, the same thing what we talked about the island. In the island, what was the battery capacity? 3 megawatt hour. What was the power capacity? 1 megawatt. So the C rating of that system is 0.3C or C by 3, C divided by 3, which means your energy storage capacity is for 3 hours, but your power dispatch capacity is for only 1 hour. So it is C divided by 3, or you can call it 0.3C rating. That is how the C rating is calculated, which means what is the time of discharging and what is the time of discharging. Cycles or lifetime, we all know that, you know, we have in house, we have a battery. So every 3 years you have to change that Exite or Amazon batteries and stuff like that we used to have in our house, which is a lead acid battery. So 3 hours once, 3 years once, you have to change it. So if you take one cycle per day, for example, you charge the battery fully, you discharge the battery fully and charge it again fully is one cycle. Lithium ion batteries, you can go for 10,000 cycles, which means almost like I would say 4 or 5 years or even 10 years you can run these batteries depending upon your cycles of operation. Self-discharge is nothing but the degradation pattern of the battery. For example, every system has a degradation pattern. You take your laptop, the more laptop gets heated up, the laptop starts slowing down, which means it loses its efficiency. Similarly, battery also loses its power because it's ultimately it's a chemical system, right? It's a electrochemical system. So there is an efficiency drop that happens. So self-discharging is nothing but over a period of time, what is the amount of power that gets discharged from the battery, which is not available for us to use. Then we talk about energy density. Energy density is basically whatever per, space of system. So within a less space, how much of energy density that you can install. Then your capital cost, basically, I that's what I said. While you talk about a lot of technical parameters, it is also important to understand what is the commercial viability of that. If you see lithium-ion batteries, high efficiency, high discharge rate, good C rating, lower self-discharge, at the same time, it is nominally costed. So it is important to see. And also the application. So peak hour shaving, you can use it for power smoothing, ancillary services, T&D referrals, microgrids. You can lithium-ion battery can be used many places. Your mobile phones, satellites, calculators, everywhere lithium-ion battery systems are used. So that is why lithium-ion based systems are today most prominent battery storage system. So this is a techno-commercial explanation about the various technologies for you. Potential growth. As we saw, one of the parameters that growth story of storage happens is because of cost reduction. It is also to understand which application is pushing this growth, which is the major application that is going to push this battery storage growth in the industry. One is time shift application. Time shift application, we saw. What is time shift application? Whenever you have renewable energy sources of power in the night time or whenever a good source of power is available, you charge the battery and discharge the battery when during peak hour. Peak hour, whenever your tariff is higher. We saw about the time of day tariff. I explained to you about it. In the evening peak, your tariff is very high. You pay more power, more money for the electricity that you use in the evening. So you can charge it in the night and use it in the next day, morning or evening, whenever your tariff is higher. The second major application is renewable integration. What is renewable energy integration? Today, we are hearing so much amount of solar and wind power plant capacity being added in the grid. Means people are investing heavily. Electricity boards are investing heavily. Central government is investing heavily. Our Pradhan Mantri has told 175 gigawatt of renewable capacity will be added into the grid by 2022. India has added already 50 gigawatts of renewable power capacity, solar and wind. When you are adding so much amount of renewable capacity, you need to have stability of the grid. So battery storage will be required. So renewable integration into the grid is also going to push the growth story of battery energy storage. What is the market of battery energy storage? Just imagine by 2040, the storage capacity is going to be globally 400 gigawatt hour. 400 gigawatt hour is 450,000 megawatt hour of energy. And these are the applications which are going to use battery storage. So majorityly transmission, commercial, electricity vehicle, energy shifting, peak capacity, and ancillary services. Majority peak shaving, energy shift application where you store the power in lower tariff time and sell the power in higher tariff time. So these are the applications. So you can decide all these EV charging area. You can look at your carrier. You can look at your carrier in transmission side. You can look at your carrier in energy shifting or energy storage side. So all these gives you an idea about which industry and which consumption points are going to be big. The cumulative global story, if you see, and which are the countries that are going to be dominating the space with respect to energy storage deployment, see 930 gigawatt of installed capacity is going to be there by 2040. Here I am talking about installed capacity. I am not talking about the energy. The energy could be even multiple times. The energy could be four times of this. But here we are talking about the installed power capacity of the battery, which is going to be 930 gigawatt, which means 930,000 megawatts. And which countries are going to be dominating here? US, China, Japan, UK, South Korea, and the others, India will come. India is also there. Slowly, even that small portion of India is more than 300 gigawatts. It's huge. What is driving this? Today in the comparison sheet, you saw that lithium ion. So you can see the blue triangle, right? In 2020, where are we? Around $200 per kilowatt hour. But by 2025, the price of lithium ion battery is going to be $94 per kilowatt hour. By 2030, it is going to be $62 per kilowatt hour. Which means from today's current price, it is going to be one third of that price in 10 years. When this price drop will happen, it is like mobile phone. I think I used to, not mobile phone, I'll give you an example of an interesting thing. I used to date my wife, you know. She was in Madurai and I was in Annamalai University. In 1996, I'm talking about. We used to have this internet browsing centers. How many people remember going to internet browsing centers? There is only two email boxes that time we had. One was Hotmail. The other one was India Times. There was no Gmail. There was no Yahoo, nothing. So we used to book half an hour and 1 hour slot in the internet browsing center. They will charge you 30 rupees or 40 rupees for 1 hour. So that is the only time where we can go and browse and send emails to your girlfriends or your family, right? Today, we are talking about mobiles. Just few thousands, you can do anything, everything. You can do video chats, whatever, what all you cannot do, you can do anything. Why? It's because of the cost reduction and the technology improvement. And that's exactly what today everything is free. You do everything free. While I was paying that much amount of money and I have to book slots for sending one email to my fiance, today I can do anything, everything. This is all because of cost reduction. An industry growth story is always based on two parameters. One is the essential raw material should be available in abundance. So there is a lot of investment that is happening in the mining sector for lithium ion mining, because lithium ion ultimately is a heavy metal, right? It has to come from the earth. There is a lot of investment that are happening to mine lithium ion as lithium metal. The second is the prices are dropping. The prices are dropping so heavily that this story, whatever we are talking about, is already becoming reality. That is the major driver that you ought to understand. So please, if anybody is interested in energy storage as your career, this is the right time for you to get into it, because the market is opening up and there is huge, means literally huge potential to grow. So people can contact me. I can give you ideas about how you want to get into the space. Right from fourth year, if you start doing it, you will have 1 year of experience and then you will have a bright chance of getting absorbed in any of the organizations. So please start focusing there. People who are interested in research, there is huge amount of research happening in the battery energy storage technology systems. Being electrical engineers and electronic engineers, you can find your space in the research also. So if you want to be in the research side for battery energy storage, best time to bet on that. Revenue stacking application. As we talked about, as I told you in a commercial understanding, a technology will always grow when you find there is a revenue mechanism for it. Did anybody think about Amazon becoming so big 15 years back? Have you any time thought that anything you want to buy will come to your doorstep? My father or me, when I was young, I need to go and stand in the ration shop to buy that sugar and parupu and arisi, right? Today, I can sit in my home. Okay, I don't want this company. I want this brand. I want this organic dal. I want this specification. Just click on a button. It is delivered to your home. Why? They created a revenue model. They created a lifestyle change in you. Right? This is revenue model. And that industry is growing today. Which are the industries that are growing heavily during the COVID situation? Pharmaceuticals, delivery, food and essential delivery to your home. Have they got any recession? Never. Now this is becoming a new norm of our life. So the revenue model, if the industry doesn't give money to people, nobody will invest. So the industry will die down. Right? Typically, revenue streams are very important. If you take a solar plant, if you just invest on a solar plant, the only revenue that you have is whatever is the power that you are pumping into the grid. You get paid for the number of units that you have pumped into the grid. But in a battery storage, there are multiple revenue streams for you. You can, of course, energy tariff, which means you are storing power, you can supply the power, you can get paid. Capacity tariff. What is capacity tariff? I'll give you an example. Have you all heard about the Black Day that happened in UK? UK grid went off. I don't know how many people got that news. Please keep watching international news. In UK, because of some reason on the grid failure, reasons not known to us, 20 minutes, the complete country was shut off in one part. There was no grid. Grid failed. Black start. That time, people who had battery stored energy, they can pump capacity into the grid and they get paid. This amount of capacity I pumped in, I get paid. Peak power tariff. There is a separate tariff that is available from battery energy storage because you can supply it in a particular time period, which is not available in solar. In the night time, between 6 o'clock to 9 o'clock, your solar doesn't generate. So there is no revenue. Firm power tariff. When the grid is fluctuating, right, you need to supply firm power, which means when there is a huge amount of renewable energy, the grid is not getting firm supply of power, you can pump firm power from the battery. There is a revenue for you. Ancillary services, frequency control. We will study what is frequency control, voltage control, black start. You have multiple revenue streams. You can use the battery for multiple application. That will drive this market. Now come to service and operation of a battery. It is important for us to understand a battery very clearly. I am dividing this battery cell. You know, you have a small cell, just to give you a very practical example. There is something called as a minimum SOC, state of charge. You cannot take that power out. It is a redundant power that is always kept in the battery system. You can't take that power out. So it is like a minimum non-dischargeable capacity available in the battery. That is called a state of charge. Now, there is a major portion of the battery which is storing energy. And that part of the battery is used for energy application, which means you store a lot of energy and discharge little bit of energy during 1 hour, 2 hour, 3 hour, 4 hour. The major part of the ramp up application or power application, these applications are called as energy applications, which means in energy application, the energy stored in the battery will be higher, but the power that you dispatch will be smaller, like 3 megawatt hour, 1 megawatt battery in the island says. If you go to power application, it will be reverse. Your energy stored will be lesser, but your power dispatched will be very high. So, for example, the same island application battery, if I reverse this, it is 1 megawatt hour of battery, but 3 megawatt of discharge. Somebody can say, sir, how can I discharge 3 megawatt with a 1 megawatt hour of battery? It is easy, which means you are not discharging it for 1 hour. You are discharging it for only 20 minutes. So that entire 1 megawatt is discharged in 20 minutes. That is the amount of energy that power that you are dispatching. These are used for ancillary services, ramp rate control. Sudden requirement of power, you discharge heavy inductive load. Inductive load, you all know that, you know, you start a motor, induction motor, your current requirement to start the motor is very high. Where is the typical example of an induction motor? Not like that Nanban movie, that induction motor, no. Take a mine application. If you take a mine, let's say a cement plant, Madras Cements, okay? We take Ramco Cements as an example. Ramco Cements has a crusher unit, which means the limestone, which is coming from the mine, it is put into a crusher, right? The crusher crushes the limestone and makes it into a powder. And then it goes for cement production. Now, when there is a huge rock of limestone coming into the crusher, what does the crusher need? The crusher needs huge amount of power or current to crush the limestone. So at that point in time, the motor that is used in the limestone crusher unit, it is an inductive motor. It needs a sudden amount of current inflow. Where will you supply from the grid? Battery will be coming in. Within that 10 seconds or 15 seconds, 1 minute, 2 minutes, you will supply the entire power that is available from the battery. So that current is dispatched. This is ramp rate control, ramp rate application. Then you have a differential supply mechanism. That is basically like, you know, you supply demand supply mechanism. So what is the demand? According to the demand, you supply power. Frequency control, we will see exactly. Reactive power control, we will see. Black start, we will know that suddenly the grid is failed. You can supply power from the battery. So this is the two application, major application that you need to understand when you are studying about a battery system. One is energy side application, which means you are storing more energy, delivering less power. Power application is you are storing less energy, delivering more power. Let's get into some examples and applications of a grid curtailment and how battery is used during grid curtailment. This is a very typical example of a 25 megawatt wind power plant in Tamil Nadu. In Tamil Nadu, unfortunately, the problem that we have is Tirunelveli. Many of you people would have been from that side, even Coimbatore side. It is a very rich wind area. If you go to Theni Mavattam, if you go to Tirunelveli Mavattam, Tuticorin Mavattam and all, you will find lots and lots of wind power plants, particularly people who are from Polachi side, Udumalapet, they will see a lot of wind turbines operating. Wind turbines are infirm power. Can somebody say that when the wind turbine will operate? Vayu Bhagavan only knows. Whenever Vayu Bhagavan gives us air, you will get wind power. But what happens in the grid, because of the load, the grid will put off the substation. They will stop the substation. When you are stopping the substation or the transformer is put off, and that time when the wind plant is generating, what will happen to the investor? He cannot pump the power to the grid. So his all revenue is wasted. So this is something called as grid curtailment. You are curtailing the power that is being generated. At that time, what you can do? Whatever is the power that is generated in the wind, store it in the battery. And whenever the grid is available, pump it to that night also. This will give a grid curtailment balancing. So the first application which we are seeing now is whenever there is a grid failure or a grid curtailment or a load shedding happens, and renewable power plants particularly, where you cannot control the generation side. Can somebody control the solar generation side? Surya Bhagavan eppa power kudukuraro appo da. So we cannot control the solar generation, we cannot control the wind generation, but we can store that power because they are free, they are available from nature. We have to use them, so we can store it and pump it to the grid whenever the grid is available back. The second one is energy shift application. We talked about the energy shift application with respect to the tariff trends. Now the left side graph tells you that your load, the load is constant at 2500 kilowatt hour, which means the load is available in the grid for 2500 kilowatt hour is a constant load. What are you doing sometimes in the solar? The solar is generating more than the required load. So that excess generation from solar, what are you doing? You are storing it in the battery. Correct? So if you see the orange graph, that just below the same replication of that mountain below that as an iceberg is called storage import, which means you are importing the power from the solar power plant and storing it when the excess power is available. And look at it in the evening between 6 o'clock to 10 o'clock, the blue color triangle, you are dispatching, which means you are exporting the stored power. Correct? So you store it in the excess time that is available and use it in the time when the renewable energy is not available. The right side graph is basically a graphical representation and the tariff. So you can also see that the tariff in the evenings are very high. So you are able to curtail the tariff and save money by using the power that you have stored in the morning hours from solar and using that power in the evening. So this is a major application which is called as energy time shifting application. And this is going to be a biggest driver for the growth of battery energy storage systems in the market. The third one, exactly. So this is another way of representing. So you have a peak load, you discharge during the peak load. You have the green color is times when you don't have demand, load demand is not there. You use that power to store your battery. So this is a sinusoidal wave of a battery storage system. So peak hour, you discharge, non-peak hour, you store it. And this is used for energy shifting application. This is just another representation with respect to some capacities. Like say, for example, 5 megawatt is the average load. Peak load is 10 megawatt. Sometimes the average load, it goes, the demand goes below the average load. So you have excess power, you store it. The third application is ramp rate control. Ramp rate controls are basically given by thermal assets today. For example, the peak requirement. Let's say we have Ennore power plant, we have Neyveli power plant, Lignite Corporation power plant. You also have Mettur dam, which is having pumped storage. Now everything is operating. For example, everything is operating. The dam is not generating more power, but the water is stored in the dam. Or let's say you have a gas turbine power plant. You have a gas turbine power plant in Tuticorin. Now, suddenly Chennai city requires 500 megawatt sudden power in the evening. What is called as ramp rate? There will be some time that will be taken by the gas turbine or a diesel generator plant or a thermal power plant to ramp up its capacity and generate more power to supply the 500 megawatt power that is suddenly coming from Chennai. The system will forecast it. Like, you know, the system will forecast with respect to, okay, how do I generate the power? When will it be required? But nobody can say that this much exact requirement of ramp rate power is going to come. But if you store capacity of power in the battery, within seconds, you can increase the power output from the battery and that ramp rate can be met with. And if you're also doing a solar power generation, for example, as a smart an application of solar, as I told you that the solar can also have infirm power supply. Suddenly one cloud will come, you can see the drop. Suddenly the cloud goes up, it goes up. So it is a very, very sinusoidal system. So the second application that you can also do is smoothening. So whenever the cloud cover comes, the battery will discharge. So the power flow is smooth. It will not be varying. And whenever the cloud comes back, the cloud is gone, solar power generate, battery will go down. So you can actually smoothen the power flow from a solar plant using a battery. So this can also use in the ramp rate control system. This is another application of a battery system. The third one is somebody asked for frequency control. So it is a typical example of a frequency control. So on the left side of the graph, you have an active power requirement. So we all know that we operate at 50 hertz, right? 50 hertz is a frequency of our grid. Whenever the grid is going down, which means what happens? There is a huge demand reduction, right? Suddenly there is a demand going down. So the grid frequency is dropping. So what you need to do, you need to support the grid with active power. So you discharge the battery. The blue color is discharging power to the grid. So the grid will again come back to 50 hertz. Now the grid is having big supply. That is a lot of supply into the grid, but there is no demand. So the grid frequency will go up. That time what you can do, you can charge the battery by drawing the power from the grid. Again, the grid will come back to 50 hertz. And this balancing is called as primary frequency response balancing. So you balance this frequency with respect to charging from the grid or discharging from the grid through an automated generation control. And this is a very major application, power application for a battery energy storage when you talk about grid level system. Value chain. So I'm just taking a small example of a battery. What is a battery system? value chain is. There are currently in the lithium based system two technologies are used, lithium fluorophosphorus, and you have nickel manganese cadmium, so NMC. These are two technologies, both are lithium based only. The base metal is lithium. These are electrochemical chemistry, like, you know, the catalyst that you use for electrochemistry, right? Cathode to anode, flow of electrolyte, we call it. So these are the electrolytes, fundamental electrolyte chemistry. So you have a battery cell, that is the cell that you are seeing. The cost of the cell is between $100, $110 to $120. Then the cell becomes racks and modules. The first photographs I showed you, these are the racks and modules. So each of these cells are made into racks and modules. Then you are putting it into a container. These racks are kept into a container where you need to maintain temperature of the container, because these batteries are very susceptible and very sensitive for temperature. So what you need is a HVAC system. What is HVAC system? Heat and cooling system. So you need to have an AC, right? So you will have an AC which maintains the temperature. You will have a thermal management system, which means you have to maintain and control the thermal. So you will have thermostats, you will have thermal measuring systems, you will have control systems. Then you will have your fire suppression system. We all know that lithium ion is very dangerous. It can burst, it can create havoc, it can, it's a safety issue. So whenever overcharging happens, so many times we can see that, you know, in mobile, we keep the mobile near our head, charge it in the overnight. You don't even know when the overcharging happens. Please do not do that. Never ever charge your battery full overnight. Always charge your battery when you are awake. And with the moment the charge is 100%, stop the charge. Don't overcharge your batteries. Pura full night charge la potittu irukkiradhu, it is not at all an advisable thing. Then you have your switch gear, energy monitoring system, PCS is power control system, power conversion system. All that is contained into a container. Then you have a transformer, then electrical and structural balance of system. You have a CT, PT, you have a transmission line, and then you pump it into the grid. So this is a typical value chain of a battery energy storage system in the market. The market players. So some of the names you know very, very well. Tata Power, Mahindra, L&T, Honeywell, Siemens, GE, Wärtsilä. These are some of the names that you know. Delta, Sterling Wilson, of course. I'm representing Sterling Wilson. So these are all the global players which are there in the product side and also on the EPC services side. So you can also find out much more players. Rolls-Royce is there. Daniel Kreischer, which is Mercedes-Benz. They are there. Siemens is there. There are some thousands of Chinese companies are there. Powin, there's lot of American, European companies, Nidec. Now everybody wants to Rolls-Royce, Ford. Ford wants to come in, RPG, Raychem. So there's enough amount of companies. Adani wants to come in, Reliance. Everybody wants to come into the space. So this is some of the interesting names that you can think about. Schneider Electric is there. Delta is there. So all your electrical companies, whomsoever you can talk about, Amaron batteries, Exide batteries, all of them wants to get into this energy storage system, lithium energy storage system. So this is just to give you a perspective about who are all the international and local players in the market. And before we close the session, we will also take one more futuristic example, which is DC-DC coupled system. So far we were seeing that you have a AC side, which is you have a generation side, which is DC, and then you convert it into AC through an inverter, and then the battery is also put across into the DC side, and then finally you convert it again AC and convert it cell. There are possibilities there. Solar power generates DC. Your battery is also DC. You can have a DC-DC converter, and then commonly have one inverter, which is DC to AC, and pump it. So there are DC to DC converter based inverters are coming in the market. So these are already getting deployed, but this is the future for battery storage. This creates even more efficiency, because you are actually avoiding one more inverter in the solar side. So that efficiency again improves, because inverter means your conversion is there, capacitors are there, that there is a loss of 1% or 1.5%, that can also get avoided if you have a DC-DC coupling system. So this enhances the generation because the losses are controlled. So you can have better optimization. So there's a lot of advantages across this DC coupled system. So I thought I'll just give you an idea about what is the next development that is happening in the conversion side. So with this, I thank all of you, I think, to patiently hear almost for 2 hours. I hope it gave you a perspective about what this industry is all about. I would also take a few minutes before we get into question answer sessions with respect to some of the management aspects of it. I see, I'm very, very glad to see that there are a lot of female students, very, very welcoming. Many people have this, mentality now that, the gender bias, how the industry is looking at, particularly this electrical industry being a core industry, how genders are being looked at. I'll tell you, globally, gender equality is a very big topic in the corporate world. Every corporate leader or the management is talking about bringing in gender equality. Gender equality is not only from promoting a particular set of population. It is also to bring in discipline. It also to bring in equality in humankind. It is also to bring in efficiency, because in corporate world today, people have realized that I don't have any shy to say that females are much more efficient than male employees. They are focused because if you take your mother, she is the most prolific example of how efficient a female can be. She handles your home, she handles a kid, she handles her husband, and she handles the society, and she handles her office as well. They are the best multitasking people. And this is naturally available in them. They may be weak emotionally, but that is the responsibility of every male to emotionally support a female candidate to bring them up equal to us. We cannot avoid or be complacent about being a male in this society, because the efficiency doesn't differ because you are a male or a female. It is on the ability and attitude of the particular individual, and which the corporate world is today realizing no more gender bias. With this, I wish all of you a very happy engineering and all the best for your final exams, and wish you all a very, very great career. Thank you.
Yes, sir. Thanks a lot for putting up a great effort, and I believe students, not only in this forum, they have joined in Microsoft Teams, but also the people, those who have joined in YouTube, have definitely benefited out of your session. And there are quite a lot of questions. I will take a few questions, sir.
Yep.
Yeah. First confusion again people has because they have predominantly adopted for lead-acid batteries in the real time what they are seeing. Means though they confused with the life of these batteries. So can you just throw some light of this lithium-ion batteries?
Okay. Fundamentally, why we are shifting from lead-acid to lithium-ion? Lead-acid battery has got a couple of disadvantages. Because of the electrolyte, which is lead-acid or sulfuric acid or acid-based system, it is very corrosive. It occupies a lot of space, because if you are energy density. What is energy density? The amount of kilowatt hour you can store in a limited space. That is energy density. Now, in lead-acid battery, it is very less. You have to have more battery space to store lesser power. Another disadvantage. The electrolyte has got a weakening thing. After 3 years, the electrolyte loses its potential. You can't generate more and more power. You can't keep storing and discharging. It has got its problem because of acid. It is an acid, so it loses its chemical properties. So you have to replace the battery. So it is cost effective. It is not a cost effective thing. So which means if you're talking about a cycle time, lead acid battery has a lesser cycle time. Now the technological advantage is lithium metal. When you have a lithium metal based cathode anode system and you have an electrolyte made, they have got a higher density. So you can, in a small piece of a battery, cell battery, you can store more power. that is one advantage. Second advantage, when energy density increases, your power and energy output also increases. And space is a big cost. So that is another advantage with lithium ion. And the cycles, lithium ion has got a deep discharge cycle, which means in lead acid battery, you cannot go beyond 70% or 65% of discharge. But in a lithium ion, you can go up to 90-95% discharge. So that provides more cycle, more discharge, more charge. So your cycle increases, lifetime increases. That's another advantage. So that is why we have moved from lead acid to lithium ion. So when the cost is dropping, so it is obvious that your energy density increases, your cycle time increases, your depth of discharge increases, your reliability is increasing, and the cost is also dropping. So it is obvious that you move from a lead acid battery to a lithium ion battery. And that is why lithium ion batteries are more prominent. And that is the way lithium ion battery is working. With respect to the cycle time you are asking, cycle times are nothing but, as I told you, one full charging, discharging and charging cycle is one cycle time. So typically a lithium ion battery, if you are operating it for one cycle per day, which means 365 cycles in a year, you are operating, right? So if your cycle time of a lithium ion battery is between 3000 to 5000 hours, which means your lifetime of your battery is 10 years to 15 years. Now people are even talking about 20 years of lifetime. So your lifetime is increasing. Just imagine a lead acid battery which occupies more space. 3 years after that you have to discharge, you have to throw the battery out. Here you can invest a lithium ion battery for almost 10 years it can come. So that is the fundamental difference that between lead acid and lithium ion.
Yes, sir. I think you have answered that question, because in YouTube chat, few people commented that 2 or 3 years is a life of the lithium ion. That's not so the case, as you rightly told, bare minimum 10 years. And again, it depends upon the cycle life, but at least one cycle per day, it will at least come for 10 years. And as you told rightly, the researchers are on, and already 15 years is also there from few manufacturers, and research is going towards 20 years. Yes, sir. Thank you for that. And one more question again with respect to the battery. Lithium ion batteries against the flow batteries. Means flow battery is more energy density, and why it is not so popular? Question, something like that.
Yeah. So again, as I told you, flow battery, sodium sulfur, flywheel, hydrogen based, all these are in research field. So lithium ion, for example, 10 years, 15 years before, we all know only lead acid. We never talked about lithium ion. Lithium ion was used only in our mobile phones. Because the prices dropped, lithium's efficiency went up. Lithium became more popular. Down the line, 5 years, nobody knows, flow batteries become more popular. It all amount of investment people do, amount of researches happens. Now what will happen if flow batteries needs to be more efficient than lithium or more popular than lithium, then the efficiency of the system needs to be more. So the research has to be faster than what is happening in lithium in the flow battery to make it even more efficient, so that people will adapt to flow batteries. It is a cycle. I will give you a very practical example. We used to see that Solider TV, right? One ad, very interesting ad. Solider TV in our old house, it used to be a picture tube. You know, big picture tube behind. You know, it has got all its electronic component. All. Today, anybody has picture tube? Everybody is moved to from picture tube to, they call it something, and then we moved to LCD, liquid crystal diode. Then we moved into LED, light emitting diode. Now we are moving to plasma, right? This is a technological advancement. So from a picture tube based TV, LCD came and gave a lot of features for you. From LCD, which was a crystal diode, you went into light emitting diode, which is even more cheaper and even more better. Then you went into plasma TVs now. Likewise, right now, old systems were lead acid. Lithium ion has shown that it is more efficient and more cost competitive than lead acid. So now we are using lithium ion. Tomorrow, flow batteries have to prove that they will be even more efficient, even more longer life, even more lesser maintenance, more energy density. Then we will go to flow batteries. Maybe future, who knows? It can be anything else.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. There is another question. If you are able to take up that question regarding the supercapacitor, that means they want to have some idea, because nowadays many people are talking about the supercapacitors, flash charging in the electric vehicles. So it's getting attention, of course, in the academic side. Many people are looking that as a beautiful future. So, means from your view.
Okay, I don't have much knowledge about supercapacitors, yes. But whatever I little bit of understanding I have is what you're basically trying to do is you're trying to store what is a capacitor or a rectifier. Whenever you need to convert from one form to another form, you're just using them as a intermediary component. That's all. Supercapacitors are, if I have to compare a supercapacitor, they are like super servers. You know, we have these in IT industry, we have the super servers, right? You're storing terawatt hours of data into one server. Typically, supercapacitors have got the capacity to store humongous amount of energy into a very small, tiny space. It is very difficult to say whether supercapacitors are going to be the game changer, because handling a supercapacitor is very difficult, because the amount of energy that you are storing, if there is a safety issue, it cannot be controlled. So that is my basic understanding about supercapacitors. I don't know the technical definition of supercapacitors. Maybe Selva can help me.
Yes, sir. Yes. Yeah.
But this is exactly the commercial understanding that I have about supercapacitors.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Thank you. Even I mean, I keep repeating. Actually, Krishnan sir is basically a chemical engineer, and because of his talk and his discussion with the power system, might be even a first time I have misunderstood him as a power system engineer. So the same note I can give it to the participants, those who are joining offline as well in YouTube. So I will take up a separate session for this supercapacitors, but only one small note, supercapacitors are high power for a very short duration. So like battery can store it for 30 minutes or 1 hour or 2 hours, supercapacitors can store the energy only for a few seconds. So like flywheel, it can store only for a few seconds. So these are all maybe high power applications, but low energy applications. So that's not really suitable for, I mean, smoothing the wind or solar for longer durations. So in that case means you need definitely a battery. Yes. Sir, I think there are few questions in the chat box in the channel also. Yes, sir. Thank you. And one more correction, sir, which I want to convey you. Means you have mentioned this pumped hydro in Mettur, that is basically in Kadambarai, 400 megawatt pumped hydro in Kadambarai. And that is in Coimbatore district where this college is there. So,
oh, fantastic.
It's about 40-45 kilometers from the college. So the students, those who want to, I mean, really visit, that's a marvelous pumped hydro which they can see. Yes.
I think you should go, if you are nearby, don't waste your Saturdays and Sundays. I think your college is a very renowned college. They can write to the station and definitely they will permit you to come and visit that. Please go and learn it. It will be a very good thing. So just to tell you about a pumped storage, recently the Solar Energy Corporation of India, which is under the Ministry of Renewable Energy and Power, has come out with the peak power tariff bid. It was a 1.2 gigawatt, which means 1200 megawatt of tender that they called for. And one of the companies called Greenco from Hyderabad, they bid for that project and they won about 600 megawatts.
900
in that project, 900 megawatts. Sorry, thanks, Silva. In that 900 megawatt, they are going to go for pumped hydro to support that project. So it is important also to know that pumped hydro in India can also become a very good technology for energy storage. So
yes,
if you have a time to go and visit that plant, please do it.
Yes, sir. Thank you, sir. There is a question from internal chat box from Mohan. Can you throw a bit more light on battery management system, BMS? And is there any similarity between this BMS and BESS? His question is like, he has not really understood what is BMS. So can you just throw some more light on BMS?
Battery management system is nothing but a controller. I am giving you a very layman definition. It has got a lot of components. I don't want to get into the circuiting of a battery management system. It is basically a controller. So we saw the racks, right? We saw the battery racks. You have cells and these cells are put together in a module and each module is put and they call it as rack. Battery management system is actually above the rack. Each rack has got a battery management system. So what that the battery management system does is it is a controller which controls the charging, discharging, current and current dispatch and the qualities of the battery. That is the battery management system work. And while it does that, it also communicates with the PCS, which is the power conditioning system or power conversion system, to provide these data about the health of the battery. This is the basic application of a battery management system. So every battery system will always have a battery management system. It is not a separate component of a BESS. It is inbuilt component of a BESS for every lithium ion storage system, that it controls the charging, discharging, voltage, temperature of the independent battery rack and communicates those to the power conversion system, so that overall the battery health is maintained and monitored.
Yes, sir. Yes, thank you, sir. There is another question again from same Mohan. AC supply used to avoid the arc interruption in circuit breaker. We open circuit breaker at zero crossing point. My question is how to extend this arc in the circuit breaker in DC, because battery you are talking about DC.
Yeah, so arcing is nothing but a power, a current flow which happens unpredictably, right? That creates arc. Like for example, if your load is sudden current goes, your sizing is not separate, or your breaker close, not close, you create arc in an AC system. And AC system arcing also happens with respect to your power flow. In a DC system, it is a constant flow. So first of all, there is no variation. And DC systems are very simple. The voltages are very less. So there is not many opportunities for you in a DC system to have arcing. That will be my answer. Majority of the arcing happens when you have sinusoidal systems at the AC side. So in DC systems, arcing generally doesn't happen. What happens in a DC system is binary. It either happens or it will blow. Like say, for example, in a solar plant, you have a, behind the solar module, you have a junction box. Junction box is nothing but a diode, and it has got a bypass diode also. It has got a fuse, right? So it, if at all there is any change in current or voltage parameters or anything, it will either flow the current or voltage, or it will just burn out. So that is what happens in a DC system. But in an arcing, where you can have impulsing arcing, that happens in an AC system, not on a DC.
Yes, sir. Yes, thank you, sir. And if anyone has any other questions, probably you can unmute yourself and you can post a question. Any questions?
Yeah. Hi, sir. This is Jeevan.
Yes, Jeevan.
Hi, Jeevan.
Sir, actually, thank you for the valuable lecture. You really helped us for understanding the overview of microgrid. Sir, I have a query regarding the frequency control. So the question is, actually, for the conventional grid, actually what it is existing in the, for the conventional grid, there is a, as you already said, that there is a automatic generation control, or whatever it may be, the governor control, use it to control the frequency of the all the governor, all the generators, because all the generators are get synchronized to the single grid. So it is taking for the overall grid, they're maintaining the frequency constant. But while you are connecting the microgrid to the conventional grid in the grid connected mode, so as you said that, so since you have to increase the power to maintain the frequency during onload, so actually you said that the battery will get discharged faster rate to maintain the frequency. So for the conventional grid, we are maintaining the governor. So it will take care of the frequency, sir. But in case of microgrid, who is the control part which will take care of the discharge rate of the battery?
Yeah, that is your PCS, power conversion system. The PCS will discharge the battery into the grid. So first of all, we need to also understand, it's a very good question, Jeeva, why this frequency controller system is important when you have a microgrid. That is itself is a fundamental question. So when you have a grid system, like when you have an automated generator controller, it always talks to the generator, and it will control the generator frequency and makes it into a constant supply. Let us assume that the grid does not have any renewable power at all. There is no solar power, there is no wind power, nothing is flowing into the grid. The grid will smoothly operate. There is no problem. But now what we are doing is, because we want to reduce the cost of power, solar is cheaper, we are pumping in solar power. Let's understand, there is no storage. The power of solar is directly pumped into the grid, and you have an automated generator controller. But in the solar system, the voltage and the systems are very less. The grid is a huge ocean. You can't dilute the grid's operation because your small solar plant wants to pump power. What you will do, you will cut off the solar plant in order to save the grid. While you have infirm power going in, which means more and more solar power is added to the grid, what you are actually doing is, you are actually adding infirm power into the grid, because solar is not going to generate constant power. So when you have such variation of power, but the load is constant, you have to reduce your generation from the thermal asset, right, which is supplying you firm power. That is what the controller can take. But if you don't have a battery and if you don't pump the power at that point at rate that you need to do, which is done by the PCS, your answer to the first question, this is what is creating the frequency drops and voltage disturbances in the grid. Because you are adding more and more infirm power and reducing the thermal generation to balance the load. And once that is created, the only problem, only solution to that is to give sudden surge of power, active power into the grid to control it. So first question answer is your PCS, which controls the generation and pumps the power into the grid. And from the grid side, it is the automated generation panel that does that.
Yeah.
Okay, sir. Thank you.
Yes, sir.
And the second question is, sir, can you speak briefly about some microgrid protection system?
Yeah, SAR is not basically an electrical engineer. Okay. So let me put it this way. I will take up this session separately.
Sorry, sir.
No, not a problem.
Yeah. So even, that's what, as by his presentation, I have misunderstood him as a power system engineer in the past time, but that misconception might be there for everybody, those who are listening to him when he's talking about the microgrid. Basically he's a chemical engineer. That's also a lesson for the students. Along the way, what are the additional things which you have to learn that is most important, which you need to learn along the way, and you have to take yourself to the next level. I believe he's chemical engineer, then he has moved to the business development, he has learned the management skills, business development skills. As he has rightly also pointed out this, gender parity. That's all the things students has to take along the way, just not necessarily focus or narrow down just to the books and subjects. Yes, thanks a lot, sir, for joining us, and you have made really this Saturday a wonderful day, just not for me, it means also for about 40 people joining in this Microsoft Teams and about 30 plus people joining in YouTube. Thanks a lot for your session, sir. Now I invite third year student from Government College of Technology, BEEEE, Karthik Soumya, to propose the vote of thanks. Karthik Soumya?
Yes, sir.
Yes, please. Go ahead.
Gratitude is an expression of a thankful heart. A wonderful morning to everyone. It's my pleasure in proposing the oath of thanks for today's session. On behalf of the most prestigious 75-year-old Government College of Technology, Coimbatore, and students of Electrical and Electronics Engineering Department, I take this opportunity to thank the Power Projects for providing us with a virtual internship during this lockdown, which is highly useful. We feel thankful to Mr. Krishnan, Rajagopalan, an eminent and an impeccable speaker, for having accepted to deliver a lecture in his busy schedule. And we are awestruck in today's session, which was about microgrid and battery energy storage in business perspective, which was really informative, sir. We also express our heartfelt thanks to the organizers for organizing this wonderful session. Adding to it, I thank all the people from industry, the colleagues from Government College of Technology, and my dear classmates. On the whole, it was a pleasant experience for all of us to be the part of this utilitarian session. Thank you once again.
Thank you so much, Soumya. And I really thank Silva and Power Projects always being a very, uncommercial way of transferring knowledge to the humankind. Selva, you're doing a good job. Continue doing this. And thank you, students, and thank you, professors, teachers, who are all there on the call. My namaskarams to all of you. And really thank you all to patiently hear to me. I'm sorry if I was a little faster or anything that I missed out in your minds of clarifying. Please contact me or through Selva, no problem. And stay safe under this period. Spread your wings. Don't confine yourselves to books. Talk to industry people and make sure that your horizon of knowledge is not only reading books. The horizon of knowledge is always spread when you learn, we listen, and you practically go and implement it through case studies and industrial visits and your connections and relationships that you built across the industry. As Selva already told you, every field has got vast areas of growth. Today, the field that we saw is microgrids and battery storage. It is the future. It is happening. and there's a lot of research, business, commercial opportunities available in this space. So I wish you all the best, and make sure that these times that you spend in the college is very widely used. Have your enjoyment. At the same time, make sure that you prepare yourself for the career that you want to plan for yourself. Thank you. Jai Hind.
Yes, sir. Thank you. Thank you, sir. And with your words, I believe students will definitely take this as a positive, and they will work on it. And definitely they will be there in your organization. At least 2% or 3% of the people, those who are listening to this today's class, will be there in your organizations in the years to come. Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Thank you.